Thank you for inviting me to give some information to all of you about a method that has been developed on our lab to look at aging, estimating aging whales using fatty acid ratios in whales. David Herman is the one that actually has been doing this modeling. He works in my laboratory, and I'd like to thank him for his help with this. So I'm going to give a little bit of background, and then I'm going to go through three different species that this is these types of models have been done. So aging of whales is needed to determine population status, long-term viability, and explore a wide range of age-related effects. And there are several different methods for aging cetaceans. Necropsy samples from bycaught, subsistence, harvested, stranded whales provide teeth, baleen, earplugs for growth layer analyses. There's also methods to look at racemization of amino acids and eye lens tissues. This is being done in bowheads. Photo ID, long-term studies, they're difficult to maintain and they're costly, but they're very important and provide some very good information. Telomeres, DNA, skin biopsies, this is being developed in various laboratories. And today I'm going to talk about age estimations from fatty acid ratios in the outer blubber biopsy samples. And these are in two different publications, one looking at killer whales from the eastern North Pacific and humpback whales from both the Gulf of Maine as well as southeast Alaska. And then my final example will be belugas from Cook Inlet. They're viable and non-lethal. So here are the sampling locations for the eastern North Pacific killer whales. Samples were collected from both marine mammal eating, the transient killer whales, as well as the resident fish eating killer whales from various areas. The furthest south is the southern residents here and samples all the way to the eastern Aleutian Islands. So the first thing that we noticed with the animals, we looked at the lipid classes in the biopsy blubber samples, and we kept noticing that for the older, the adult females, that they had higher percentages of these wax sterol esters in their blubber. So it got Dave thinking. Anyway, he first wanted to look at these to see if there was any type of relationship with age. There's somewhat of a relationship, but as you can see, they're different for females versus the males. The males are the closed symbols, and the females are the open symbols. And there's also differences between the residents and transients. So then he decided he wanted to start looking at fatty acids. So he looked at the individual fatty acids, and we use a GC mass spec mass spectrometry to measure these compounds, and he's looking at anywhere between 65 to 80 fatty acids in the blubber samples. And what he found is that the correlation of individual short and medium chain monounsaturates, branch chain, and odd chain fatty acids with known ages for Eastern North Pacific resident and transient killer whales, there were some relationships, but they were these individuals. You can see that there are differences for both the blue and the red, the resident and transient killer whales. So here are is short chain monounsaturates, these are the branch chain, these are the odd chain. So what he found is that no single fatty acid alone would predict the ages of both resident and transient killer whales from the eastern North Pacific. So what he started looking at were ratios of these different branch chain, odd chain, as well as the short and medium monounsaturated fatty acids. And what he found is he found this nice linear relationship. And here we're showing the age, the actual ages of the animals versus the predicted ages from his model. And he's got two different terms here using these different kinds of fatty acids that I mentioned and showed in the previous slide. And it was a pretty good relationship. The R-squared value is 0.89. And his precision with this model is plus or minus 3 years. So it's a little less than decadal. So in conclusion, It appears to be robust. It was independent of ecotype. It was independent of where the animals were from, say, Puget Sound versus Eastern Aleutian Islands. It's independent of sex. It was independent of diet. And it predicts ages with good precision. Can be used to predict age distributions in Eastern North Pacific killer whale populations where ages are unknown. For a lot of those animals that are in remote areas, they may not have photo ID catalog information on a lot of those animals. We don't have a clear understanding of the underlying biological mechanisms at present on why this works. And the results were published in Marine Ecology Progress Series. Come and see me and I can get you some more information. I can pass on copies of the manuscript. So the next example I'm going to show are of humpback whales from the Gulf of Maine as well as Southeast Alaska. Blubber biopsies from both known age and minimum aged whales were taken. They were also taken from both feeding grounds up here as well as breeding areas down here in the West Indies. And for Southeast Alaska, you had most of the animals were sampled on the feeding grounds, but there were a few that were taken on the breeding grounds. So we're looking at two different populations as well as different areas. And they have different, they feed on different prey species in the Gulf of Maine. Sand lance, herring, euphausids are primary prey, whereas in Southeast Alaska they are krill and herring and some other species. So here we're looking at multidimensional scaling analyses of fatty acids from Gulf of Maine and Southeast Alaska humpback whales. Here Dave's showing all the fatty acids combined and doing this MSD plot. Below is just looking at the dietary fatty acids only, and you can see that there are differences between the Gulf of Maine and Southeast Alaska, which we expected to see. Fatty acids in the lower panel, predominantly dietary in origin, shows that they are different, and the outliers Dave showed were very young animals that were probably still nursing, but those are more easily aged in the field than for adults. So the first model I'm going to show is for 28 Southeast Alaska humpback whales. And again, he has two terms with fatty acid ratios that drive this model, and the precision was plus or minus 4.5 years using this model. These points, exact age are the solid squares. The minimum censored age are the non-solid squares. Anyway, he used a Tobit-Wright censored multilinear regression, and he was trying to see what it looked like for a single population. And one of the points he made here is that these were minimum estimated aged animals, and from our model it appears that they're much older than the minimum estimated age. Still within decadal precision estimation of age. Here we're showing a model that was developed. Now, these are different terms for the Gulf of Maine versus the Southeast Alaska, these fatty acid ratios. These are for 34 Gulf of Maine humpback whales. Again, the exact age animals are in the solid. The minimum censored are in the non-solid circles. Again, those animals that were minimum aged, according to our model, they were probably older than they're estimated. And for this one, the precision is 3.1 years. And in this set, Juke Robbins provided some of these samples. They had sampled the same whale with at least 2 years apart, and the model still held for that. You can see that these ratios are increasing with as they sampled them later on. This is the same figure, but Dave separated it out looking at sand lance feeders. There are some of these animals that are more specialized feeders, such as sand lance feeders versus herring feeders, and then there's some unknown specialization. Basically, the presumed sand lance feeders, both of these fit on the for the model quite well, and then he just X'd these out just so people didn't get confused. But the other thing to note here is that even the non-feeding animals that were in the West Indies, this model still held true. So even if they were in the feeding areas or the breeding areas, so feeding status doesn't appear to be a problem when it comes to these fatty acid ratios to help predict the age. And again, this is predicted age versus known age. Then he combined the two populations and developed a model. Again, these are different terms. Exact age, Gulf of Maine, are the solid circles. The non-solid circles are Gulf of Maine minimum censored. Exact age, Southeast Alaska, are the solid squares. The non-solid squares are the minimum censored. For this model, the precision was plus or minus 5.3 years, so decadal again. Appears to work fairly well. Again, some of these animals that are, they were minimum estimates of the ages of the animals. According to our model, they are probably older, but it still seems to hold true for this species as well. Just using different terms than for the killer whales. So the conclusions, for this model, it was based both on exact and minimum age killer whales. It was robust in that it predicted decadal estimation of age and appears to be largely independent of sex, diet, and feeding status. Age prediction uncertainties improved with single population models. And then these data were published in MEPS in 2009. If you'd like a copy, I can give that to you. Again, we have no clear understanding of why these fatty acid ratios work the way they do. And in the future, we'd like to replace the minimum age data with known age animals as the catalog. You get more older animals in the photo ID catalog. In this technique, we'd like to be able to extend it to other humpback populations just to see how well it works for those animals. And here's our last example. Dave looked at Cook Inlet, Alaska belugas. These data are from Dan Voss's thesis project, where he looked at teeth growth layer, which is on the x-axis, versus length. And this is assuming one growth layer per year. The red symbols are for the females. The males are in the blue. This is a von Bertolaffy length age model that was created. There's a couple things to note. It starts flattening out after, at different ages for these animals. And also note that there's not a whole lot of data points for females from about here to here. So there are some missing data points, but these were based on 22 males, I believe, and 17 females. They were collected from 1992 through 2001. They were collected as part of the harvest, as well as from necropsy animals. Unfortunately, the tissues collected from these animals were not preserved such that we could do fatty acid analyses of them. So over the years, beluga biopsy samples have been collected, as well as blubber samples from necropsied animals that were in good enough shape that we could do the fatty acid analyses. We can't really do this on animals, on stranded animals, where the body condition is not very good. Anyway, as you can see here, the sample type, he's indicated the trocar biopsy with the TB versus N from necropsy, so it is a mixed bag. And it's assumed that greater than or equal to a length of 340 is for females or adult females, and greater than or equal to 415 centimeters are adult males. So this is the data set, and he wanted to look at just rather than, because the relationship on the length versus age estimation from Dan Voss's stuff, he wanted to look at the juveniles first because there was a linear relationship there. So he created a single fatty acid ratio that exhibited the best correlation with age for physically for the juvenile Cook Inlet belugas. And again, the precision is for this model for the juveniles is plus or minus 5.8 years. And again, this is for females less than 340 centimeters and males less than 415 centimeters. The interesting thing is that this fatty acid term is the same fatty acid term that was in the killer whale model. It was the second term for the killer whale model, aging model. So it appears as though there may be something going on that's similar between these two species from these two areas. So the other question is, okay, so this worked for the juveniles. How about for the adult animals? How does the model look compared to what the estimations are for those animals? So the adult animals are shown here in yellow, and these are Dave's estimations using the one fatty acid ratio model. And it makes sense, most of the data that he found, they are definitely above 8 years of age. I think one of them's pretty old, assumed to be pretty old, but I don't know how, if belugas get to 76 years of age, but they can reach at least 50. The males held true, the same thing, they were above, most of them were above 21 years, but it's within the 5.8-year estimate. So in conclusion, Dave, instead of having exact age animals, he derived it from allometric body length versus age relationships described by Dan Voss in his thesis. He based the ratio of a single pair of fatty acids and allows ages to be predicted within almost a decadal for juvenile subadult belugas and appears to be independent of sex. It appears to be contiguous, thus enabling the ages of mature adults to also be estimated. We anticipate that age prediction uncertainties will be substantially reduced when biopsy samples from animals of exact known age are acquired and their blubber fatty acid compositions fit to a model that has two fatty acid ratios, similar to killer whale and humpback whale models. But I think there's a problem because there's a moratorium on getting biopsy samples for these animals right now. So I think we're still going to be getting them from necropsy to help fill in some data points. Again, there is no clear understanding of why this fatty acid ratio relationship works. And this technique likely can be extended to other cetacean species. He has some preliminary data to suggest the technique may work for sperm whales. These are females from the Bahamas. He's at least looking at age classes and looking at some of these other allometric body length information. And I'd really like to acknowledge the folks in our lab who helped do the analyses and extractions, the people that went out and collected the killer whale samples and had the photo ID catalogs for the killer and the humpback, same thing, and the belugas, because without those data we couldn't possibly do that. The data don't mean anything to us. So it's really kind of one of those multidisciplinary type studies that you can gain some information if you all put your heads together and figure stuff out. And a lot of these samples were collected to look at contaminant levels and or for feeding ecology studies. So this was kind of a plus in being able to estimate ages of the animals. And with that, I thank you.